taking the test. I still want you to do it. And oh, one more thing. And then when you're all done, after the exam, bring them in. I'll collect them again so I can use them again next year. I use these for about, you know, 3 or 4 years. They just
good morning, staff. Just a reminder to have third period students log into their Teams and vote. Here,
right
third
now.
Period. Once again, students, a reminder to be voting, and that's via your Teams.
I'm proud about the vote. I know that's
thank
important,
you.
But I also have a lot of other things going on. So, everyone, go take your notes out while I get the thing ready for the vote. All right, I'm going to put this on the board. I know what you're thinking. This is so exciting. So, everybody, we're going to quick vote. We are the class. You're the class of 2025, aren't you? So, use your camera. Can you get the QR code?
As soon as you vote, you can go, okay?
And I'll move this stuff out of your way. Quick scan. Can everyone see it? I think that should work. Scan, vote. I know we have a lot of competitors in this very classroom. Vote early, vote often. It'll be like an 1890s feudal election. Huh? That's a key thing. I didn't sure they're gonna count. They just want you to vote. I'm so tired of counting the votes. The new America. Oh, you are. I don't. That's legitimate. They might throw that out. All right. Are we voted? Are we voted? I'm checking the forecast again. Tomorrow. It's always rough on the parade if the Thursday rain. 56% chance of rain on Thursday.
I love that.
That's so it's going down, see? The parade day is supposed to be 58 and partly cloudy. That's happening really nice. We got a 90. One year was 95.
Oh.
Ooh. There are some hot people. All right, let's get started. Everyone voted? Good job.
Does my vote matter?
Huh?
My vote.
Your vote.
I do it.
You're actually, I didn't want to tell anybody, but they're only going to count yours.
Oh.
Yeah. That's the new democracy. You just can pick one person at random. If anybody still has this, please turn it in. So the practice test, please do them. I'll collect the Scantron. You can hold on to them if you want to look at them again. We'll do another one on Thursday. And just a multiple choice. We'll look at other questions. And while you're doing it, keep working on the packet, etc. And on Sunday, 5:30.
Yep.
5:30 p.m. The door will be open right up here. This door. You come down the stairs and walk into here. We'll pack in here. We'll quick do it. And I will go over so much. You will not believe how much I will talk about. Yeah. So I'll cut the Scantron on Monday, and then I'll give it back. I'm just going to give you one. Everybody, though, grade yours. The key is at the back. Please grade it. If you get over 60%, you're fine. You get over 70%, you've done very well.
Yes.
So don't worry about 90. Yes. Don't worry about 90, 80, 70, 60. And with errors you're not sure about, you know the errors in the look, go back in the review packet, make sure you go through it. And hey, they're going to ask questions in such a way that three, maybe even four of the answers might look pretty good. So you have to narrow it down. Don't leave anything blank. If you got to answer the last four C, do it. I don't think you have any trouble. I think you'd be done if you didn't. And if you're not taking the test, take it anyways. I want you to. All right, let's go take your notes up. Can we get to rock and roll?
Yeah.
We get to hillbilly music?
Yeah.
Do we get to Chuck Berry?
Yeah.
So Chuck Berry invented music.
I thought you did.
I know. Thank you for that, but. I really struggled playing guitar. My left hand just didn't work. Yeah. Yeah, I struggle with it. It's really sad. But people can do it, I'm very impressed with it. So as you can see from this mountain valley, Chuck Berry. Did I play Chuck Berry before you left?
Yeah.
You just want to hear Chuck Berry again.
Yeah.
I would love to hear Chuck Berry listen.
I adore Chuck Berry. He's one of my favorites. Even though he was a great musician and a great artist, he's not necessarily the nicest guy in the world. But one of my great regrets is that I could have saw him in 85 and I missed him. I didn't go. I can't even remember why, but I'm still upset about that. You have seen my favorite music. Yeah, he would do his duck walk. Now, in special topics, we finished the year with this year of rock and roll, and I do a lot on Chuck Berry because it also my personal taste, but he invented music. I don't care what anyone says. And the thing is, though, what made it so effective in marketing, which also part of the reason why it became it's such a classic form of music and it's shaped music to this very day so much. It was very American, and regardless of culture or color of skin, it was all American music. But in the very racialized society of the 1950s, white parents were fearful that their white children were listening to black musicians. And this really, in a way, accelerated the generation gap and made the music more exciting. But at the same time, then they started trying to figure out music producers, once they figured out, wow, this is really selling. Now we need a white singer to appeal to white audiences. Now, to take nothing away from this person, they found him. Do you know who they found? Who was an incredible singer and a great talent, but he was white to sell the white. Because Chuck Berry never had a number one song. Partially because of color of skin. He didn't have a number one song until 1971 when he did a novelty song called My Ding-a-ling.
Oh, no.
And I'm not going to comment any more about the song except for really Johnny B. Good and all these great songs and that song. But so you want to hear a little bit of Elvis? All right, a little bit of Elvis. Oh, no, I lied. See, I knew what you wanted to do. He actually sang this song. Elvis is a stick. That's totally cool. All right. Elvis appeared on the Ed Sullivan Show. Ed Sullivan, this popular variety show. That's part of the stick. He shook while he sang. He shook. And so they were so worried this would corrupt America view. They only showed him from basically his stomach up, right here. And so we're gonna watch this. And it's kind of amusing, but also I'm kind of worried about showing you this because some of you will lose control. And the first song he'll sing was made popular by and the party would never end. Yeah, it got a little bit out of control then. We had to step, you know, the cats got involved. I love that picture so much.
But
and soon it would become more and more, how do we sell to a wide audience and appeal to them? And rock and roll would actually, I'm not saying there wasn't great songs, but it would begin to decline. I should add, remember I told you about they brought back the draft? Well, the draft board was mad at Elvis. They didn't like him. And so they drafted him in Memphis, Tennessee in 1958. He went to the Army. And it kind of looked like it might be dying. There would be, you know, some popular music, but we have to get back to the 1960s a little bit later on. And while we're doing that, we have to move on, and it's kind of fits right in the growing movement for civil rights. Now, we're going to watch something about this after the text. Something I'm running out of time, but it's so good, I want to show you. I know you will enjoy it. So we're going to watch it after the text. That's going to be a good thing, just kind of a good little day. A little bit of history, but at the same time, from a show I think you really enjoy. So remember the double V from World War II? Victory in the victory over discrimination at home and fascism abroad. That would help trigger the civil rights movement after the war. The NAACP had begun a series of tests of Plessy versus Ferguson. That's it, separate but equal. Their lead attorney was Thurgood Marshall, an amazing litigator. And he would be the one, for example, to the main argument that would lead to Brown versus the Beagle Board of Education. Thurgood Marshall would be the first African-American on the Supreme Court, appointed in 1967. He'd be appointed by Lyndon Johnson. Lyndon Johnson would do so much, it's kind of weird to even think about. But, you know, Thurgood Marshall. And he would die suddenly in the court in 1991. Well, but three big events what happened in the 1950s we have to get to. I'm going to go through them very fast. Now you will have more. We're going to watch this great thing about the 50s, and we'll talk about all three. Be a good thing to kind of finish up after the test, but we're going to go fast through it. The first one, 1955, Emmett Till. Emmett Till was a 14-year-old boy who his mom and dad fled the South in the Great Migration to Chicago. He was born there, but went back to visit his grandparents in Money, Mississippi. In Mississippi. I didn't put that down, but Mississippi. There's Emmett Till at 13. He's from Chicago. Now, Chicago was pretty segregated. Remember redlining and what's happening with white flight. But still, significantly more freedoms for African Americans in Chicago than in Mississippi, the Jim Crow South. Well, we don't know exactly what happened, but according to, where's my mouse? Carolyn Bryant, who was working at a store her and her husband owned, he whistled at her. And that was a line that black men could not cross in the South. Not only whistling to a white woman, but a married white woman. Now later on, she would say, I mean, literally later on, as in 2 years ago, she would say, now quite old, he never really whistled. He said something, and she was worried people might have thought he did. And she didn't do anything. So she told her husband that he whistled. Her husband and his stepbrother, so her husband, Roy Bryant, right here, that's them in court, and J.W. Millen, gone, pulled him out of his grandfather's home, drug him near to a creek, and beat him to death. Partially because he would not say that that they were better than him. They tied him to a cotton gin fan and threw him in the river. The body washed up a couple days later. Everyone knew they did it. And there would be a trial. And this was unlike other events that happened. There were lynchings all over the South. But this time, there's television, there's reporters, and it was covered. Yeah.
He was 13.
14. The picture was taken when he was 13. So he was lynched, tortured to death. Lynching is torture to death, even though we normally associate that with hanging. It's just kind of the tradition from the 19th century, weird tradition, weird way to put it. Well, they're going to be found innocent. Nobody's ever found guilty. It was an all white male jury, even though the county had 70% African Americans. That was the norm in Mississippi. They were found innocent. And since they couldn't be tried for the same crime twice, they told what happened and admitted it. Oh, yeah. They got paid $1,000 from Time Magazine to tell what they did. So they did it. Everyone knows they did it. And there was no federal law at all about anti-lynching law. Heck, there wouldn't be a federal anti-lynching law until 2 years ago. And so this, though, ironically, would trigger the movement. And the reason why is the media, especially the new media television, they reported what happened. They said what happened all over the United States. And Jim Crow laws and what was happening couldn't hide anymore. This was not done in the shadows, in the secrets, or only reported in newspapers in the North that were appealing or that were only done in the segregated African-American neighborhoods in like Chicago or New York. This was nationwide. Yeah, people knew what was happening but didn't want to admit it, and now they couldn't hide. And the movement. Basically, triple idea of the movement. Any Jim Crow laws, voting rights, but also economic justice, economic integration. And that was personified. Remember I told you about the problems with housing, redlining, and then the suburbs. This one, a lot of Northern support. This one, this will blow up the civil rights movements. 1960s and divide once again very dangerously by race. But Emmett Till, here's a meeting a few months afterwards or a month afterwards to talk about Emmett Till. This galvanized the civil rights movement, and people in the North realized we have to do something and this in the South, and the South could not hide anymore. Thurgood Marshall's right there, and he's not on the stage, but a very young Martin Luther King would speak at this right here. And there's this woman named Rosa Parks who just happened to be there. And it's no coincidence that 3 months after Emmett Till, the Birmingham bus boycott would take place. These things all happened together. And Rosa Parks, who was a member of the local NAACP, they had been planning this, even though the individual action would happen that December 1955. This was not planned, the actual day. She just decided, I'm doing it now. So what she did is she's reenacting it right here, but she was sitting near the front of a bus. The buses were segregated that they have. A couple seats in the front were all white. The next few rows were black. Blacks could sit in it, but if the white area filled up, the driver could move them to allow whites to sit there. So she was sitting in the area that blacks could sit in unless the white area overflowed. So she was sitting there and the driver told her she had to move. And she basically was like, and really motivated by Emmett Till, just said, I'm not moving today. This is it. I'm staying. And she was arrested for this. And the big thing was, they hadn't really arrested people before. They'd always just intimidated them. Once you have an arrest, you have something you can bring to court. I should add one more thing. All right. Claudette Colvin, who was 15 years old, tried the same thing 6 months earlier, and she was arrested. But since she was a minor, it was a different offense. And nothing came out of this. The reason why is because it was before Emmett Till. And so didn't have that immediate anger, we have to do something now, we can't wait. Yeah.
What is NAACP?
The National Association for the Advancement of Colored People. It's a very awkward way of saying one of the leading movements to fight for civil rights. And so the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People, if you put down the NAACP on the test, you'll be perfectly fine. Yeah, in fact, hardly any, because African-Americans are going to fight very hard to stop people from using the word colored to describe them. Very hard. And so that's why you have this kind of awkward legacy of the Reconstruction era from the NAACP. So back to this. Well, that is going to trigger a boycott. Now they're ready. We can't not fight a boycott. And this would be a difficult boycott in the winter of 55 to not ride the buses, which was for most African-Americans in Birmingham, the only way they could get to their jobs. So here are people walking in, you can imagine, Alabama in the winter, rain, cold, awful. But they did it. It was hard. And while they're doing that then, this case wound its way to the Supreme Court, and after 9 months, the Supreme Court ruled against segregated busing, saying that was unconstitutional. So it was a big victory. Now, there are a lot of local leaders, but a new leader, 33 years old, last second, so they ruled against segregated busing. Oh, I like this picture. So this was done very cleverly. She's sitting in the same seat. And this is a local lawyer who was supporting the NAACP, but he sat behind her. Very symbolic. I think that's clever. Martin Luther King was named a spokesperson, partially because of the couple speeches he gave about Emmett Till. And he was an eloquent speaker, very intelligent. There is talking the night of the beginning of the boycott. And the video we're watching, we'll hear a little bit of that speech. There he is getting on a bus after it, after the Supreme Court ruled. That's the actual bus, Rosa Parks refused to give her seat. That's at the Civil Rights Museum in Memphis, Tennessee, at the Lorraine Hotel, the hotel where Martin Luther King would be assassinated in 1968. It's now the Civil Rights Museum. And Martin Luther King here laid out, it was not his policy, but he would preach it and believed in it, of nonviolent civil disobedience. So civil disobedience, and not that, this is direct action. So this takes a lot of guts and it's direct action, but it's nonviolent. And it is the idea of the protest unjust laws. But I repeat, this is not therefore passive. This is direct action. It's forcing people to react. And sometimes this will be violating laws with the idea that we are protesting unjust laws. Now, some people might find these laws just. It's difficult to prove unjust laws. So part B of this is, it's a morality play. And that's what he understood. Good versus bad. And who were on the side of justice? Who was good? Well, what about those brave people boycotting the buses, walking in the rain for just the simple rights that any other American should expect? That's good. And a little bit later on, while fighting for voting rights, who are the ones peacefully riding through the South and what's called the Freedom Riders? And who are those attacking them with tear gas and bats? Or fire hoses and attack dogs. Who's just, who's not just? And that's how you prove it. And the other thing is this. King wanted to sell this as the progression of history, American history. We're fighting for the true meaning of the Declaration of Independence. We're fighting for the rights of the Constitution, especially So, and after Reconstruction, the 14th and the 15th Amendment. We're going to finish Reconstruction here. And so I do want you to add that. We're going to finish Reconstruction. And the other thing, you know, this is complex. I mean, the main author of the Declaration of Independence was a slaveholder. The Constitution is filled with compromises that nobody really liked, that we're still stuck with, partially because of keeping slave states in the Union. And so it's a complex argument, but that is the argument he would have. And for a few years, it seemed to work. After 65, this idea began to break apart. One more law, Brown versus Topeka Board of Education. Now this would be, I know we're going back in time, this is 1954. So this is a year before, it'd be this precedent that would lead to the decision about segregated buses. But it said that schools, I didn't say that, so you have to add this. Separate but equal schools are inherently unequal. That is what is in the ruling. So it overturned that part of Plessy versus Ferguson. Separate but equal. Here are protesters against segregated schools. This is a very obviously staged, but still a great picture from the Supreme Court. Staged or not, it's clever. And one of the main arguments for separate but equal would say that the schools are equal. Why do they have to have integration if they have the same schools? Well, first off, I think all of you could guess the schools were not equal. Even though I should add, in the 1950s, Southern states started pumping money into African-American schools, hoping they could say, hey, these schools are just as good, therefore separate but equal is fine. But everybody knew that was ridiculous. And the main element of the court case said it is inherently equal because of the reason the schools are separate. The schools are separate because of an inherent inequality, AKA racism. By saying one race is superior to the others, we have to have separate races and or separate schools, therefore that is inherently unequal. And they said at the best possible speed, the schools must segregate. Well, this is the first major ruling of the Warren Court. Earl Warren right here, he was governor of California, Republican governor of California, appointed by Eisenhower. And this would begin a series of massive court decisions for civil rights. Of all the Supreme Courts in American history, this court case, or the Warren Court made the most rulings for civil rights. And many of them are being reversed now. And that's Warren. Interesting group of people in that court. Eisenhower was no friend of this. He was actually quite disappointed with Warren about this. Eisenhower was not a friend of civil rights. Well, in 1957, the first state of the former Confederacy, the first school, finally integrated. That's why I put an exclamation mark. 3 years later, and a Brown II decision, 9 students were chosen to integrate into an all-white school. So you can see they're being very careful. 9 very good students, going to be known throughout history, therefore it's a Little Rock 9. And they chose a working class school. A working class school for the same logic as what happened after Bacon's Rebellion. Working class whites didn't have a lot. They knew their economic future was going to be pretty difficult, especially in the stratified South. Certainly not a lot of status, but what's the one thing they had? And if you allow black students in this school, that implies they might lose that one thing, our little bit of status. We're white, just like the ruling class. Why did they do that? Just like Bacon's Rebellion, they didn't want integration to work. They wanted it to fail so they could say, look what happened. Sorry. So, Governor Orville Faubus, who was a Democrat, they're all Democrats, he didn't want it to work and saw a political game. He said, there's going to be a riot. So we'll send the National Guard out to stop the students from going in to prevent a riot, which of course wasn't true at all. But naturally, you say there's going to be a riot, people come out. And there would be a mass protest against integration. They were able to call eight of the students and tell them to not go. She didn't. She didn't have a phone. And so she had to walk through an incredibly hostile flag. I should add that it was bristling with Confederate flags. Remember, the Confederate battle flag became the symbol of anti-integration. And here's a protest in front of the Capitol. By the way, race mixing is, of course, as we all know, communism. And with that, the school would be shut down. Eisenhower even called in, ordered Faubus, said, you got to come here, and said, Eisenhower, no friend of civil rights, said, you have to let these students in. And Faubus said, sure, then went back and said, no. Eisenhower was furious and ordered in the 101st Airborne Division. Now, he's no friend of civil rights, but he sent in a regiment of crack U.S. Army soldiers. This is an elite division to enforce integration. And the federal government, therefore, from at least for the next 14 years, will be solidly behind integration. There are the troops escorting the students in. And meeting them at the car. Eventually, they would go home. You can imagine what Faubus is going to say. This is Reconstruction again. Another Reconstruction. And Faubus would use this to be reelected six more times. Governor of Arkansas. But these events would be the trigger of the modern civil rights movement. Emmett Till. I always want to say Birmingham, but Montgomery and Little Rock. So, yeah. It's Birmingham. Once I have it in my head wrong, I can't get it out of my head wrong. It's Birmingham. I want to call it Montgomery.
I think it is.
It's Montgomery. This is one of the problems I have. Once I get something wrong in my head, I can't get it out of my head wrong. And then I'm just like, it messes me up. It's Montgomery. It's not Birmingham, it's Montgomery. And I know that. It's so stupid. Once I get something wrong in my head, it won't leave. And then I just can't get it back. It's Montgomery. No, I'm not going to change that. I will change it later. It's Montgomery. All right. So let's get to the back to the Cold War. Part of the issue of the civil rights movement was the Cold War. God, okay. Of course it's in Montgomery. See, Birmingham in 63, 64 would be some of the biggest protests for civil rights.
Wasn't there really
a letter to Birmingham? Yeah, a letter to Birmingham. That's 1960.
Okay.
And that's why I just, you know, all Alabama's the same to me.
You should keep it in there
on the clusters on Twitter. No, because I'll screw it up. I will screw it up. So John Foster Dulles was the Cold Warrior Secretary of State for Eisenhower. Okay, John Foster Dulles. And he had an interesting past. For example, he helped French and British intelligence, even as a private attorney, overthrow a democracy in Syria because they thought it might be communist in 1948. And so he had this as a cold warrior path. And he would be the bomb thrower that would allow Eisenhower to look tough on communism. His idea was called brinksmanship. And brinksmanship was literally...
Give me a sec.
Write down brinksmanship. That was literally threatening nuclear wars.
Brinksmanship.
Does that make sense now?
Yeah.
I don't. Everyone's out to get me. And you guys are doing nothing to protect me.
Sorry.
Yes. Yeah. Because I'm so busy screwing towns in Alabama. I do want to go to Biloxi. Can that help anybody?
No. Where is that at?
Oh, yeah.
In the south.
In the south, thank you.
In the United
States. All right, here we go. So it's literally the threat of nuclear war. And nuclear war against who? Yeah, the Soviets. And they said, hey, we got the truce in Korea by threatening nuclear war. It'll work. Now, what happens if they call your bluff? And the war got significantly more dangerous, the arms race, because of a new weapon. It was decided in 1950, right after Korea, that the United States would pursue the super. By the 60s, this will be called the hydrogen bomb. A bomb that would not only be significantly bigger, they're not really sure how big it can, or how what the maximum size is. They would eventually build a 100 megaton bomb. And today you might see them called thermal nuclear bomb. That's a hydrogen bomb. And in 1953, the United States would test Mike 1. Here's Mike 1. 10 megatons. 10 million tons of TNT. The biggest bomb the United States ever would make would be a 20 megaton called Bravo. The Soviets would explode the Tsar bomb, a 50 megaton bomb. Now, this is the size by mushroom cloud of the bombs. See these little dots right here? You see these tiny things right here? Let's expand that. That's the Hiroshima and Trinity bombs. That gives you an idea how big these bombs are. So one of these bombs would destroy New York City. I mean, gone. Everyone killed. Or the Helena Valley. The arms race got a lot more dangerous. So let's put it this way. 100 Bravo, 100 Mike-sized bombs exploded around the Earth would destroy the Earth. 10 would end civilization. There'd be no life. Well, there'd be 10, there'd be life, but 100 destroy the world. Everything be dead. There'd be still be an Earth. Yeah, but everything be dead. At least everything that matters to us, especially us, would be dead. So, Eisenhower, though, was acting tough on communism because he had a new defense program. It was called the New Look. And the New Look was emphasizing one simple fact that Eisenhower believed and didn't want to tell anybody because it might look soft on communism. Defense spending is a waste of money. He saw it as throwing money down a well. Think about it. He's a five-star general. Why is it throwing money down a well? Okay, let's say you make a tank. Great, you made a tank. Sure, yeah. Steel, other, you need steel manufacturing, everything else that went into it, production of the tank. Sure, you created some jobs, a little bit of economic growth. And then what does a tank do for you?
It sits.
I mean, the best case scenario for a tank is what would happen? Or is the best case scenario? No, but for people that someday you don't you discard it, you don't use it. That's best case scenario for a tank is you don't use it, and you eventually get rid of it. What's best case scenario for a nuclear weapon? Hey, you disband it. And so he saw it as throwing money down a well. He thinks the United States should be saving money. The U.S. won World War II, not because of its military might, but because of its economic might. Mike, the U.S. was not a big military power at all when the war began. So, He would emphasize atomic over conventional weapons, because conventional training, like tanks, iron bombs, artillery, a lot more expensive. I mean, think about it for a second. Let's say you're flying one of these new planes built at the end of the decade, an F-105 Thunder Chief. It could fly almost 2.5 times the speed of sound. Imagine dropping one of these unguided 750-pound bombs on Capitol High. So you're flying at about 35,000 feet. They're all unguided back then. How hard would it be to put that bomb on Capitol High? 750 pounds. So it's not a nuclear bomb, it's just a 750-pound bomb. It created 20-foot crater, but think how hard it'd be to, how much training. How much training would you need to drop a mic-sized bomb to destroy Capitol High?
No.
Drop it. The really big training you need would be, got to hit the valley, and then fly out of there before I'm caught in the shockwave. It's cheaper, so we could save money. Stop, and then his hope was, that could stop the army. Eisenhower's plan was to end his term as the general, the warrior who brought peace. That was his goal. I showed that that's part of the reason why he's going to be called a communist near the end of his term. And so, a couple more things about that. And so we started doing mass testing all over. That's part of the reason they show how tough we are. They blew up a bunch of islands and they started moving the tests to Nevada. They started putting soldiers and Marines in these tests to show that you could use atomic bombs to stop Soviet tanks and the soldiers would be fine. Of course, that's an illusion. There actually became big tourism about this. So Nevada would advertise it in Las Vegas, come watch the explosion, then go back and gamble. And then this very awkward picture of her doing a pose, a model doing a pose with a mushroom cloud over her head. So, everyone got the practice test? What time is the review session? 5:30. 5:30. AM or PM?
PM.
I understand it can't be there, but I will tell you a lot. I would highly recommend going. Yeah. Huh? Sunday's review session. Yeah. And tomorrow, remember we're doing practice test 2019. Over, a little bit over an hour. It's your life are getting tired. If you gotta go, you gotta go.
It's not till 11, but I
was
like,
we'll be done. I can't. Last year, usually I go by, you know, I will cover, I'll talk a little bit about some things for 25 minutes or so, then I review as much as I can. I go over everything. If you want to come in at lunch, I'll review. I'll go over any questions you have.
This lunch? I can't come in today.
You have to what? Oh.
Is that lunch square starting next
week? I'll start today if people come in. I'll go over anything you want to go over. Anything.
The books are really bad about, I've read both of them, and then sure. I can't find my notes sheet from it. But the books are bad about the Indians at the very beginning.
The American Indians, I know all of those.
There's like no information. It's a gap.
See ya. How are we doing? You have your four documents? Are you going to put one more in? Are you laughing your third paragraph?
Yeah, my fourth.
Okay, so beginning of class tomorrow. Oh no, you gonna be here tomorrow?
Do you
come and book at lunch, I'll throw them all in.
Actually, I should probably throw my name on
that. You're the only one, so I'll have it right here. All right.
I had a bad realization. I completely
The recession hit hard, man. I just got home late, and like when I looked in Teams, I saw something for Tuesday, and I thought it was gonna be next Tuesday.
Just happy. I'm trying to get as much out as I can now. So as long as you have, get the material.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. All right.
Quick, it's off. If those feet stop moving, I'll go at lunch. Okay, so what's coming to lunch, I'll answer any questions. Yeah. Yeah. So I'll let you go get lunch or do whatever you want. And then. And I will go over anything you want.
It was kind of weird. It was kind of good, but like, also kind of yeah. Like a plan.
You can ask any questions from the review pack and anything from page 11 or anything about the, about any other stuff. Okay. Everybody. If you didn't grab it yesterday, and some of you weren't sure if you're going to be here or not, grab both practice tests and the answer sheet. You're only doing the multiple choice. They're really handy. I'm not kidding. Just going through them helps. Regardless if you're taking the test or not, you have to.
That's really good. Okay. Yeah, we should look at that.
That's
not mine at all.
No, Thursday we're doing practice tests. I'll tell you which one. One of those.
Okay, but not going over.
No. So we're doing a practice test in class tomorrow. If you're not going to be here, you got to do it on your own sometime. Set your watch up or your clock or phone, whatever. You know, 55 minutes. Mike, it's.
I know. Hayden.
What do you want me to do? I need to write my notes.
Wait, you're voting on the analysis of the person? No, we need more representation.
Wait, that's your only reason?
Like, that's what I'm like.
Wait, you hear nothing at all?
All right, so tomorrow. Yeah.
I wrote
that. So tomorrow in class. So if you're here tomorrow, just bring this. We're going to do this one. Practice test 2019. You got that? Phone's going away, yes. We're doing 2019 right here. And bubble. See, you get to practice bubbling. Isn't that going to be fun? And then my homework, my Friday assignment. No, Friday's a school day. Oh, I'm afraid. Don't shake your head at me. Same deal. Just do the multiple choice. And the print is small because you are young.
I don't know if you're both.
Or right, you're either young, yeah, you're, and that ages you. This it's good practice, and yeah, then you can learn areas you don't know. And if you got, if you got a guess, narrow it down. One thing, every question, at least they try to do on the AP exam, or every choice, at least three of them are going to seem kind of logical. You're just going to have to, or at least ones that are kind of true, even though they might not apply. They won't have any ridiculous ones. You're any patently ridiculous where you go, oh, I know that's not true. Yeah.
So are you going to be grading these?
No, you're going to grade it on your own.
So, yeah, it's not one to grade unless it's just.
No, I'm going to give you some points. I'm going to give you points for review. Now. So you just have to hand it to me done with your score. And if you get below 50%, you have to go back to your. I don't make the rules. I can't. Just do your best. If you get over 60%, you've done fine. You get over 70% correct, you've done well. So don't worry about 90, 80, 70, 60. That's not the way they grade, and that'd be unfair for me to grade that way either. I'm just going to look at it. Good job. I see you graded it. Go back and look at the ones you missed. It's fun to fill in bubbles, right? So they're both fun on this page, see? And if you, I don't, my guess is you, all of you will be done 45 to 50 minutes, pretty easy. I don't think you have any trouble getting there. But let's just say, remember, if you have like two or three questions left and you have like 5 seconds left, what should you do? Everything's C, you know, get answers down, get answers down. Now we got the job. So let's go take your notes out. Did we get here? We got teen culture, right? Did we get to this?
You were on teen culture, and then you were just about to talk about it. I believe.
I've never.
Yeah, so we got some 2018. Yeah, they're all kind of mixed up. I just got these. Monday? How was the pep assembly, by the way? In one word. No, pep. All right, so this teen culture, do we get the generation gap? Do we get any of this?
Yeah, we
got the marketing for children.
Yeah, so and the big thing was television could be used, and that's where you get things, you got hula hoops, like drive-in movies, but specifically for teenagers and not for adults. Not for adults, at least specifically. And it's still, that still happens today. There's so many things marketed for you that's not marketed for adults. For example, you can all go watch a 3D movie. I like that one. Ah, together. And drive-ins and things like that. Yeah.
What was the point of the drive-in?
What purpose does it have? Real cream. You got to keep your hair nice.
Oh, it's hair.
Yeah, it's hair. It's thing you put in your hair. It's a grease you put in your hair to hold your hair down. That was the style that everyone had. And don't forget, nobody showered or took a bath in the morning. And so everyone had bedhead, so you had to smooth it down. Or women would wear curlers in bed and something over their hair to keep their hair styled. Yeah. Showering in the morning, that's a relatively new thing. So, rock and roll is the best example of this. Rock and roll music. This new development that came out of jazz, blues, gospel, but the two biggies, rhythm and blues, and which was called at that time, up until 53 or 52, it was called race music and hillbilly music. Which today, what is that called? That's country. Country was called hillbilly. And it was actually a pretty negative connotation, but this had a real blending of an American music of different cultures, and people all over helped invent this movie or this kind of music. There were a lot of popular white and black musicians who did it. And part of the way they could sell it and market it to young white teenagers is by saying, this is something your parents wouldn't like. And in the racialized society of the time, you can imagine how that could be for listening to black musicians. And rock and roll music basically made modern music to this day. It still follows the same model that Chuck Berry right there, who I would argue invented music. That's my way of saying I really like Chuck Berry.